Welcome to the SBI podcast. You're joining the most watched and listened to show dedicated to B2B revenue growth. My name is Melissa Valdez, the Director of Client Engagement for SBI. Our guest today is Gary Schwake, Vice President Business Development at Active Network. Gary is a revenue growth expert who co-founded two companies, taking both from concept to successful exits. Today, Gary serves as an M&A expert, where he leverages his extensive experience to develop business plans, raise capital, build the teams, grow the companies, and negotiate final transactions. We hope you enjoy the show. From SBI's Executive Briefing Center in Dallas, Texas, the most watched and listened to content in B2B sales and marketing, it's the SBI Podcast with your host, Matt Shares.
Welcome to SBI TV, a weekly show dedicated to helping you make your number. Today, we're going to demonstrate how the acquisition of a smaller company can help spark organic growth and the steps to achieve maximum value from the investment. My name is Matt Shares. I'm the CEO of SBI. I'm also your host. Joining me in the studio today is Gary Schwake. Gary's the Vice President of Business Development at Active Network. Gary, great to see you.
Good to be here. Thanks, Matt.
Welcome to the show. Thank you. If you wouldn't mind, could maybe introduce yourself and Active Network and talk a little bit about how you ended up where you are.
Yeah, sure. It's been a fun journey. I'm at Active Network, Vice President of Business Development, which means a lot of different things in different companies. In this case, I'm in responsible for a series of businesses that predominantly around our consumer engagement and how we engage the consumer for the benefit of our B2B customers, as well as pulling in some data to really help them advance their business. I came to Active by way of acquisition. So they acquired the company that I co-founded called Virtual Event Bags, which is a software company that was built to simplify the process of creating, sharing, and reporting digital content for event organizers. And it was really something we started from scratch in the SaaS heyday of kind of late 2010 and 11 and came in hot in 2015 and a rapid growth enterprise that was owned by Vista Equity at the time and is now actually owned by a public company. So I went from small entrepreneurial environment to private equity environment to a public company environment, and all in the span of 2 years.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Gary, one of the things we're going to talk about today is this concept of, I mean, you've had a couple of exits, and many of your peers dream about having exits. Now, they haven't founded companies like you have. They're part of a company and trying to get an exit. So I think you're going to bring a really nice vantage point from running a business and truly having the business mind and acumen to do that, all the way to leading the commercial function and, you know, being ahead of biz dev and what you're doing now. So appreciate you stopping by and spending some time with us on
a
big topic.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Melissa, my beloved co-host, is also here with me as always. So, Mel V, I think you have some advice for our listeners and viewers on the journey that Gary and I are going to take.
Yes, I do. For those of you watching and listening, we don't want you to miss out on this jam-packed episode, but other episodes as well. SBI TV releases 2 to 3 shows per week. And if you're missing out on this content, if you have an iPhone, go to the App Store and look up Sales Benchmark Index and download your app. You will receive notifications and new content, and you can listen on your way to work, on your treadmill run, or wherever the day takes you.
Fantastic. All right, so we're going to jump into the questions. And Gary, I guess by way of sort of normalizing the audience, if I think about your journey, right, you founded a company, you've exited, right, as you talked about. I mean, being inside the Vista Equity portfolio, top decile, you know, relative to private equity, I mean, as good as it gets,
right,
you know, well-published on their success. Right. And you've also been on the side of looking at other companies to acquire. So you've truly seen it all. Run the cycle as an entrepreneur, run it inside large private and large public. So I guess as you think about that today relative to the viewers and the listeners, talk to me a little bit about when you had the vision to, and you were founding your own company, were you thinking about it through the lens of I want an exit, or were you thinking about it through the lens of I've got an idea, I've got a mission, I want to go to market on my own? And I think it's going to help our viewers sort of follow along your story.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think you would be remiss if you, anytime you go into that, obviously part of it is what does the end look like, right? It's a bit of begin with the end in mind. But if that's what is really driving you, then you're never going to make it through the trough, because you really have to believe in what it is you're doing and why you're doing it. And for us, my co-founder and I, it was really around our collective experience in sponsoring, participating, and actually producing events, and at the same time being involved in digital media and seeing this confluence of how event organizers were really struggling with this rapid shift to digital. They're relatively unsophisticated, their sponsors are relatively unsophisticated, but the expectations of the consumer, thanks to the mobile device, are exponentially higher every single day.
Yeah.
And so we saw an opportunity to bring a variety of disciplines together to help create a platform that simplified digital, that really executed a series of things for them that allowed them to punch above their weight, to really be perceived by not only their sponsors, but their audience as being digitally savvy and helping close out that ecosystem.
Yep.
That's really what drove us at the beginning.
So somebody knocks on the door, and you and I are on this show. I'm going to spend time with you on the side of getting acquired, and we're also going to spend time of you doing the acquiring.
Sure.
And the ups and downs on both sides.
Sure.
So knock, knock, knock on the metaphorical door. Somebody says they're interested in buying the company. How did you process, and I'm going to give it a little bit of a sales tilt to it, but how did you process, okay, we've got an opportunity, this could be beneficial for us, but how did you think about, like, the commercial motion? Like, how complementary are we going to be if we get acquired by this company? Am I getting access to new customers that I would never get? Am I getting access to new geos? Like,
right.
What was the process that you used to think through that? And if that was going to make good sense for you and your co-founder?
Yeah, that's so for us, it was... We took a more strategic approach versus, that was one outcome for us.
Okay.
The first was really looking at the dynamics in the space. So we started the company in late 2010. So if you think about the explosion in SaaS companies, it really was around AWS, Amazon Web Services being founded in, you know, the 2007 timeframe. And if you just look at the number of SaaS companies that were created over that subsequent, you know, 7 to 10 year period, it just is exponential.
Yeah, it is.
What we discovered was that the audience, our customers, were starting to get software fatigue. That the number of tools and solutions that they had to consider that were best of breed in a particular niche or vertical was really wearing them out. And we're seeing that today, right? We're seeing that with the MarTech stack being 7,000 some tools. And it all comes down to the ability to stitch that together and really understand the consumer, and it's getting more complex to do that. So for us, it was, well, we have two choices to grow. We had reached the point where we had really reached that product market fit.
Yep.
We had a repeatable sales process, and then it became about access to new markets. And we saw the headwinds for us that were that software fatigue that these organizers were moving back towards really wanting at one major solution that worked well, and we could follow a variety of routes. So there was go raise more money to build out a bigger sales team, but that wasn't going to give us more access. It was just going to give us more bodies to try to get that access. The other approach for us was really thinking strategically, and we'd already worked with some of the companies in the space, Active being one of them, and we saw an opportunity not only there to get additional investment to help grow the product, but immediate access to an enormous portfolio of event organizers.
Got it.
As well as the opportunity to take technology that had been built for a specific use case and apply it across other market segments that Active served.
Yep.
And so that, frankly, helped make the decision a lot easier.
So those were three very crisply well-articulated, right, strategic reasons why you did it. So let's sort of flip to the other side. If you think about the benefits of bringing a smaller company, or your company that was acquired, into an enterprise organization, and you could argue that maybe some of this impetus helped ignite some organic growth for Active, how do you approach that if you're somebody watching and viewing as the little guy getting acquired by a bigger guy, but you got to stay on, right? There might be complexities around an earnout and all these things to truly monetize it, so you still... There's still a lot of stuff on, you know, right, that you got to go get. How do you think through that?
Yeah, I think it's healthy to really understand the dynamics of the company that's acquiring you, and not just the company, but in our case, the private equity behind the company, and understanding where you are in the life cycle of that investment.
So important.
Because as we admittedly came in, I think, a bit optimistic about what we were going to be able to do. And as founders, you tend to think longer term, right? You think about the bigger vision and how these pieces fit together over time and how they compound. But when you're at the 20-yard line in the red zone of a private equity investment, the luxury of those three-year paybacks really aren't there. And so how you approach that coming in from as an acquiree, the one being acquired, level setting your expectations about what's really being asked of you is really important so that you can align with those. Because there are some things that you can do some quick hits on, and that's really where you're trying to focus, is to, to you know, add some immediate juice to the stream. And there's some things that the acquiring company can do. So, but conversely, if you're early in that cycle, and it's really, as we talked about before the session, this ability to now compound, the length of time that it takes, there is a desire to want to prove your worth right out of the gates, but it really is about being thoughtful about the markets that you serve and how that's going to compound, and thinking through all the stuff that gets in your way, right? Yeah. The nitty-gritty, how does the sales team understand your product? Are they working with the right buyer? Is this, do they even have the relationship? Yes, with the company, but is it the right people at the company that actually produce that? Thinking through all those pieces of the customer journey that create that opportunity to compound.
So last question on this segment. So, and we're looking through the lens of the acquiree. After the break, we'll talk about the acquirer.
Okay.
What kind of diligence did you do, you and your co-founder, as you thought through the optionality of, you know, active versus alternatives, up to and including potentially do nothing?
Right.
And I asked that question in the context of those watching, saying, that might be better to get access to new markets, right? That might be better to get access to new customers, like the strategic decisions that you gave. Right. How did you think about your diligence on them?
A lot of it had to do, I mean, there's certainly diligence of the people where you could get access, but a lot of it was around having a better understanding of how they were planning and approaching the market. And through that process, you begin to understand what pieces of information they value, how they structure their team, some of the softer elements of the business as well. And then also actually co-creating, helping, it probably easier to do as a smaller company, is really help co-create what the business plan looks like after the fact.
Yeah.
And in so doing, we were able to get a lot of information about their business to really understand where we saw opportunity, what we thought were potential risks, and things we felt really comfortable with. And that was really helpful for us to have a better feeling as we were going through that process of creating the accretion model, if you will, of what we were signing up for.
Yeah, it's interesting with the amount of private equity work that our firm does, and the purview that we get, the power of the investment thesis, both, wow, that's well-founded, well-documented, we have great fit if we're gonna think about putting two companies together, or lack thereof, to your point of like, wow, where do we fit, right? So if somebody is trying to acquire us, what does this mean? Because no matter what you say, the culture is going to change, dynamics are going to change, there's a new operating model, and then obviously when you're part of a larger entity, there's a set of economics that have to be materialized, to your point about the three-year time horizon, as opposed to this extended, you know, long game that you and your co-founder were playing.
Right.
So very helpful. So Gary and I are going to take a quick break. And while we do that, I'm going to guarantee you that Melissa has something of value, because she packs value everywhere she goes. Melvi, over to you.
A guarantee. That is...
Come on.
Yeah,
don't.
No. I will not disappoint. Hey, you out there listening and watching, do you want to know if you're going to make your number this year? Well, SBI has a tool for you, and it's not a crystal ball, but it is a revenue growth diagnostic tool. You spend a few minutes answering some questions about what's most important to you and your business and how well your business executes, and bing, bang, boom, the output of that is what you need to work on in order to make your number for the year. To get this fabulous tool, go to sbi.tips/revenue-growth-diagnostic.
All right, you're watching and listening to SBI TV. I'm your host, Matt Scherz. Today's guest is Gary Schwake, and Gary is the VP of Business Development at Active Network. And Gary and I are demonstrating how the acquisition of a smaller company can help spark organic growth and the steps to achieve that to maximize value from this investment. So in this segment, Gary and I are going to jump into this balance of integration, how you create this catalyst, but also how do you know it's working? So I guess with that, Gary, my next question is, as the diligence was unfolding and you guys were getting closer to doing it, did you put a time horizon and a set of metrics where you said, okay, this is going to happen. The milestones that we are going to give ourselves and our employees that are coming with us, 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, so that we know that we're tracking towards what our, you know, what our personal investment thesis was, if you will.
Right.
How did you think through that?
Yeah, our case was probably a bit unique in that in software, we were a complementary product to the core systems of Active Network, which is a series of registration and participation management software. So for those organizers and events, we're really their system of record that handles facilities and members and registrants and what have you. But we're seeing as part of that they're looking for more and more solutions around the entire life cycle, and we helped fit into that life cycle thesis. And so for us, there was kind of different phases, and the first was we fit into in a market. So we were complementary product into a market we were already serving, and it was really working to try to light that up as quickly as we could. So the first phase of that integration was really thinking through how can we reimagine the pricing model now that we're part of this as an added sale rather than a primary sale with access to existing customers. Yep. So now it moves from being a new sale to an upsell in addition to new sale, additional partners and things like that. And there's a technical component to that. There's a sales and marketing component to that. And so that was dominated our focus in the near term, really first 90 days or so. And then it was around, okay, the idea is to get that up and running as quickly as possible, and then starting to think about, okay, the real value comes now in taking this product and making it extensible across the other markets that we hadn't served before, but had the same dynamics, had the same issues. And so that's more of an exploration because as we learned, as any case may be, you go in thinking, well, this is absolutely, it worked over here, so I'm going to go do it over here.
Sure.
Market dynamics are similar, and then you realize that, well, the buying process is a little different.
Totally different.
The dynamics are a little different.
Yep.
And
so
we had to work through those things to discover that.
And then how do you think through, and what's your advice to folks as they think through the integration process? So we've done the deal, you know. Two have now become one. You've had a couple of exits, and you've seen it. And you've seen it on both sides.
Yeah.
Maybe two or three things from your perspective of what you've seen, looking back, both maybe scars on the back, oops, but also, wow, I think we got that right, and I'm going to take that lesson with me as I go and probably look at, you know, future acquisitions down the road.
Yeah, it's a great point. I think the three pieces I would think about, one is, and again, in our case in software, the kind of the technical infrastructure side of it. We had a desire, because we wanted to move so fast, to remain somewhat of a standalone component, so not really get pulled into data centers and processes and things like that, maintaining our instances with Amazon Web Services and the like, so that we could move fast and efficiently.
Okay.
And there were certainly benefits to that. But fast forward 18 months, as we'd done a lot of that development and it now comes time to pull into the larger ecosystem, we just exacerbated the challenge of doing that. So I think that if we had to do it over again, there probably would be an element of, let's bite the bullet up front so that we can take advantage of all of this power and infrastructure that's built in and then build on that. And so it's that point of about taking a little bit of time to let the process mature is, so could we have gotten there as quickly in 90 days had we done that? No. But would we be at the same place 186 months, 12 months from now? Probably farther along.
Gotcha.
And so that comes into the time frame standpoint. So that's one aspect. I think on the sales, marketing, customer success standpoint, I would, there it's probably be a little more thoughtful about it, because I think the advantage that we brought to the organization is that we are consumers of SaaS software ourselves in building our own company. Yep. We therefore see and can test things far more efficiently than the larger enterprise can. We see a new way to create content and distribute it, or to capture data and find audiences. We can turn something on and turn it off.
Yeah.
We don't have to go through procurement and installation and all those things. We just do it.
Yeah.
And so that gives you an opportunity to see a lot of different pricing models, business models, customer success. And so even though you come with your particular framework, you're actually a student of the industry. And I think that's true of a lot of, you know, you think about consumer packaged goods or whatever. They have to find their way competing against these bigger enterprises. And in doing that, they know, frankly, a lot more about what the market is doing because they've had to go do it themselves. And so being able to harness that and then bring that in and determine how you can take that at scale, there's real value in that.
Yep.
That I think, so it's the tendency will want to be to, got to hit our numbers, let's integrate, let's you know, throw it into our process, and then you lose a lot of that. Use that as an opportunity, as a catalyst to, hey, maybe we should be thinking about how we can change our processes.
But that takes an incredible amount of, I guess, thoughtfulness. Right, and some level of like discipline, strategic discipline.
It does, yes.
To adopt that, and sometimes the dynamics for those on the as the acquiree may not be as perhaps opportune or in the position that you all were in to be able to do that. But what I like about what you said is sometimes you have to go slow to go fast. All right. Relative to where you wanted to be 12 months later, you know, in that point of view. Okay. Was there anything before we go to break? Was there anything, I guess, or is there anything culturally that you use as an indicator when you think about putting commercial organizations together? You talked about sales, marketing, customer success, and the strategic discipline that you guys had when you made the decision. Is there anything culturally that you use now, having the experience that you do, to kind of assess for, 1 + 1 is actually going to equal 5 to putting these cultures together?
You have to be very observant at that, because culture is, we take it for granted at our own organization, and I think sometimes it's hard to assess at another organization. In our case, coming in, we saw that you're in a very fast-paced environment, right? There's a need to deliver results and deliver them timely, which is true in every business, but I think accelerated when you're at the late stage of a private equity-backed enterprise, where a lot of the metrics are in place and things like that. And so we had to recognize coming in that was going to be expected, right? That sometimes smaller enterprises coming in, the reason they liked being small and probably the reason they did it in the first place is because they want a little bit more fluidity to going in. But then sometimes that lacks discipline as well, and you can chase things that don't work. So I think from that standpoint, it really is trying to underline the core objectives and then how you make decisions. In our case, both organizations were very data-driven. And it was really looking through the consumer experience, customer experience, and using data to help, you know, formulate a hypothesis, test the hypothesis, and then move rapidly to do that. And so that helped us. If that's the framework of your decision-making process, there's a lot of other things that'll fall into place.
Yeah, very good. Okay, so Gary and I are going to take another break, and it's going to be just enough time for Melissa to keep her perfect streak of sharing good things with you. So let's see her keep that alive. Come on.
Oh, wonderful. Good thing good thing we don't have a live audience to boo me or applaud or anything like that. We'll just assume that they're all fantastic. I need help from the audience. I have a special request. I would like to know who you would like to see featured on SBI TV. Has to be a revenue growth leader, and all you have to do is send me an email with nominations, and I will reach out and send an invitation to be a guest. It's that simple.
Fantastic. All right, so we're here with Gary Schwake, Vice President of Business Development at Active Network. We're demonstrating how the acquisition of a smaller company can spark organic growth and what those steps are to achieve maximum value from the investment. So Gary and I are in our last segment, and Gary, I want to take it home here talking a little bit about the enablement of the acquisition. So now let's flip. Now you're the acquirer, and you are looking at the acquiree, and you're saying, okay, I'm in sign to close, and then I'm going to get ready to go into my kind of first 100 days, and I've got a value creation plan, and we know we've got to have some synergies that happen in the first 100 days and the next 100 days.
Right.
What are the steps or the building blocks that you think through and that you would recommend your peers who are listening that might be getting ready to do this should be thinking through?
Yeah, I'm probably very biased in that I consider myself a consumer experience advocate or a customer experience advocate, because I think it reveals so many things to help you make decisions. And so it's easy to think about the process as, well, we have a larger sales team and they already have relationships, and so we're going to train them on the product and how the buttons work, and then we're going to send them out to sell it, right? It should be an easy upsell. Yeah,
more.
Or here's the value prop or what have you. But again, it goes back to when every time you're adding a new element to the team, it is, what is the, how does the customer perceive? How do they make decisions? How do they evaluate where this fits in the enterprise? What does their cycle look like? It may be entirely different from your core software product or whatever that product may be. And so if you start with that journey mapping, I think that's when it's going to start to highlight the places where it breaks.
Yep.
And then you can overcome those, and then you've thought through the objections, the timing, and you can level set expectations. Can we accelerate the sales cycle? Are we unrealistic in trying to do that? Or should we perhaps be more marketing-led than sales-led in this in this piece? I think those components, taking some time to, and actually helping the sales team be part of that and the acquired company, that helps mesh those cultures together and do more than just product training. It's really thinking about customer segments.
So what I was jotting down on my note paper was the lens of client experience, right? So instead of saying, I've got an investment thesis, 1 + 1 = 5, because these are the synergies I'm going to capture in back office, and here's all the growth, let me back up and let me think about what is additive, right, to our customers as they think about this potential acquisition. What value does it bring, and where are my points of leverage? Right, as you talked about in the buyer value chain. So on that, I guess on that point, are there levers you pulled, having done this successfully a couple of times, that ensured that the value that was, suspected when you went through diligence, and the value that was realized? How did you ensure that that value is captured? And you know, same question, kind of couple of tips that you would give.
Yeah, so I think one of the things that was enlightening for us was don't be bashful about looking hard at pricing. Because when you're a smaller company, you're trying to win business, you've got the reputation challenge, you're crossing the chasm.
Yeah.
And sometimes price has to be that thing that gets you there. Yeah. And you kind of settle into what you think is market price.
Yeah.
Well, particularly in anything that's not a commodity, it's, you move to a value-based selling. It's, well, what's the real value that you deliver?
Yeah.
And the larger company now also has the ability to further support that through trust recognition, account management support, things like that. It was an opportunity for us to revisit how we priced that piece of software, that tool, that solution set, and opened up a new set of markets that we could go after that actually exponentially saw more value from it. And so that unlocked a lot of value for the acquiring company. And that's part of what we saw as the thesis as well. But I think you get overly wed for, 3, 4, 5 years of running the company, what you think the price is. And that's one way to really unlock a lot of value.
And then what about people?
Active is based in Dallas headquarters. We've got offices around the globe. We're based in Charlotte, North Carolina. And so we had a relatively small team. And so much of the team, we were very open about the strategy of pursuing a partner. We just felt that was the right thing to do. And so combination of the time of the transaction and then ultimate diligence, there were very few people actually came with us in transition. And so for us, it was really, and that worked out well for everyone.
Yeah.
It was a fantastic outcome for them. But it, from our standpoint, it was really us then working with Active to recreate those relationships.
Got it.
Not taking that for granted.
Yeah, makes sense. All right, very good. Well, Gary, I can't thank you enough.
My pleasure.
Appreciate you
Thanks
stopping by.
Me.
It's a heady topic with a lot to it, and you helped get some core philosophy, and I know our audience is dealing with a lot of this because it is a competitive market right now, and people are trying to grow both organically and inorganically, so right. I appreciate it.
Appreciate it.
So, Melvie, I think you have a final parting gift.
Yes.
For the audience. I've now turned this into a game show.
Right.
So
yeah.
We're
awesome.
Giving gifts.
I love it. Yeah. It's no, it's not a pocket square, unfortunately. But we don't want you to miss out on this great content, not only with Gary here, but other guests as well. So if you haven't already done so, please go to salesbenchmarkindex.com/register. And there you can select the topics of interest to you and when you want to receive content.
All right, everybody, that's it for today. As always, I appreciate your ears and your eyes. You have a choice on where you spend your time and the fact that you would spend that with us. I am very grateful. Until next time, I wish you good luck as you try and make your number.
This has been the SBI Podcast. For more information on the studio, SBI's Executive Briefing Center, our team, or to schedule a workshop, please visit salesbenchmarkindex.com.